Okay, well, good evening and welcome to our second session of Centering Prayer. We had the first last week and we'll have one next week, okay? So it's a three-session program, all right? So I want to welcome all those that are watching online, streaming, whatever they call it. I think it's streaming, huh? And so we're glad to have you with us. So let us lay hold of the silence that is always beckoning us to enter into it and go deeper and go into the presence of God that we call prayer. Loving and gentle God, once more you invite us, you woo us into a deeper relationship with you, to go beyond the superficial, to go into the depths of our soul where you are alive. I pray that my words, my teaching of centering prayer may not get in the way of your living spirit, that your spirit in each one's heart may truly be the teacher, the guide. And I pray this as always, in the name and in the power of Jesus, your Son and our brother, forever and ever. Okay, so tonight we're going to kind of go a little deeper into the method of centering prayer. We started it last week. I still have a few of the pamphlets on centering prayer that if anyone did not get one last week, there will be some here available. I have handouts from my last night's class on Immortal Diamond. I started it last month. The second, I'm teaching Rohr, Richard Rohr, the second Wednesday of every month. And last month I started the book, The Immortal Diamond, and I had again a class last night on it. So these are some handouts on it from the PowerPoint and other papers. I have a beautiful reading here from Richard Rohr's Daily Meditations, which really speaks to what we're going to be talking about tonight, about not judging. And so, also about overcoming your dualistic mind. So both of those, there are two different meditations there. And also at the bottom is the website where you can go to get these free daily meditations. You know, they're wonderful. They're just about two or three paragraphs, and how many people get those? Oh, look at the hands. That's wonderful. I presume you like them, huh? All right, I do too. I love them. So, okay, so let's see if we can get started here, if I can work this. Uh-oh, went the wrong way, I guess. There we go. Look at the curtain. It's just it's almost like it didn't know if it wanted to open up, right? That's like ourselves. We're not sure if we really want to open up too far. Okay, the first conference prayer as relationship. Okay. Did we do this last time? Is this
yes.
Yeah, how did we? I thought we had this third conference here. Well, we're just going to whip through these things. I remember all those little, I had it all set up, and something happened. No, we did the second conference.
No.
We did. Because there's four, and I did the first two the first night, and now we're right, the third conference, okay? All right. It's actually the second night, but the third conference, all right? Thoughts and the use of the sacred word. Okay, so let's review the guidelines. Let's read these together, because this is the bread and butter of the whole program. When engaged with your thoughts, return ever so gently to the sacred word. The sacred word is a symbol that expresses our intention to consent to God's presence and action. The sacred word is introduced when we notice that we are not just thinking, but thinking about our thoughts, and especially when we are engaged in an interior dialogue. In centering prayer, both thoughts and silence have an important role to play. Some thoughts contain what needs to be healed, and the silence creates a space for the healing to take place. Each time we turn to our sacred word is a prayer and an act of love. Okay. So, every word in this has been worked over by the centering prayer creators and deliberately put there. Because I know I helped work out some of the words when I was doing my training. So, once again, the sacred word is a symbol. It's nothing in itself that's sacred. You could use the word tree if you wanted to, or rock, or whatever it is. It's just a symbol that expresses our intention. And once again, it's the intention. The power of intention, huh? It's just unbelievable. Expresses our intention to consent. Now, notice it doesn't say our intention to do something, to produce something, to get things done, to be successful. You notice it doesn't say that? You notice that, huh? All right. Express our intention to consent to God's presence and action. You notice it doesn't say our presence and action, does it? No. It's not about us at all. And that's the beauty of centering prayer. It's not narcissistic in any way. It's all centered on God. That's why they call it centering prayer. Huh? Okay. The sacred word is introduced when we notice that we're not just thinking, but thinking about our thoughts, and especially when we're engaged in an interior dialogue. So a lot of people continue to ask me, and they're coming from sincere hearts, I know, the whole thing of, well, I just can't seem to get a blank slate, Father. I can't get a clear mind. I guess I just can't do it right, you know. Well, I guess I need to repeat over and over. It's not about a clean slate. It's not about a mind that's completely blank. That only happens when you're dead, all right? So if you have that completely blank mind, all right, it'll last a long time, all right? You've heard of eternal rest, right? Well, there it is. Okay. So it's when you notice that you're not just thinking. See, the thinking is not the enemy. The thoughts are not the enemy. We need to get that across very strongly. But thinking about our thoughts, you know, we can observe something, and that's a thought. When I notice there's a flyer here, I notice, and it's black, and it's got a little maroon color there and some candles. That's noticing. That's an observation. But when I say, wow, I wonder what that says on that brochure, and I pick it up and I start reading it, then I am engaging in my thoughts. However, if I just say, oh, okay, it's a flyer, all right, and that's a chair, you know, and this is a table, those are all observations. But when I go down and say, I wonder how this table's made, you know, those are getting into. That's when you're thinking about your thoughts and you're going into the whole analysis of it, okay? And that's not wrong. It's just an invitation to return to the sacred word. It's an opportunity to humble yourself. All right? Humble comes from the Latin humus, you know? And the same root word is human. Human, humble, humus, they all come from the same root. And it's okay. It's what God created. It's good, as Genesis says. Okay, so when we thinking about our thoughts, and especially when we are engaged in an interior dialogue. You know, some people think of prayer as a conversation with God, right? That's great, but it's not centering prayer. And it could be many kinds of prayer, and it's wonderful. It's not bad. It's great. But it's not the centering prayer method, all right? Then it's not conversation. It's going from conversation to communion, to unity, all right, to silence, to a listening heart, to a readiness to receive. That's what it is. Okay, in centering prayer, both thoughts and silence have an important role to play. Both thoughts and silence. Not just the silence, both of them. Some thoughts contain what needs to be healed, and the silence creates what? A space for the healing to take place. You're creating a space for God. You're creating a healing space for God to heal you. You're saying, here I am, Lord, heal me. I know I need healing. Anybody here that doesn't need healing, you may go, you know. You may leave because you don't need to be here. We all need to be healing as far as I know. Anybody not? Just raise your hand. The ones who do not need healing, just raise your hand. I don't see any hands, you know. We need healing in the innermost parts of our soul. We need healing from way back when we were infants. Because we're carrying all of this psychological trauma a lot of times. When someone stole our favorite toy when we were two or whatever it was, you know. A lot of that is still in there. And we need to be healed of it. And psychotherapy is good. It can help and everything. But this is the real healing. This is divine therapy. God is saying, all I need from you to be healed is silence and your presence and your consent to let me do it. And then I'll do the rest, okay? I don't need your help. I'm pretty good at being God, you know. I just need your consent and your willingness to give me space and time. All right? So, each time we turn to our sacred word, it's a prayer and an act of love. So, if you have 1,000 thoughts in your 20-minute sit, and you return gently 1,000 times, that's 1,000 acts of praise of God. It really is. It's beautiful. And it's 1,000 humiliations of your ego. That is what needs to die, your ego. That part of you that wants to be in control. That part of you wants to tell it like it is and get all the credit and do all the work and get all the glory. And that's your ego. That's what's going to die about 30 minutes after you do, you know? Yeah, it picked that long. Yeah, right. The ego doesn't want to let go. It's been in charge for a long time. And that's the obstacle, because God cannot work within us if our ego is in control. If God is not the pilot, then our ego is the pilot. And so we need to choose who do we want to have as the pilot of our life. All right. Any questions on this? All right. Now, define the term thoughts. Thoughts is an umbrella term for any perception at all, including body sensations. Let's read it together. Feelings, images, memories, plans, reflections, concepts, commentaries, and particular spiritual experiences. Thoughts are inevitable, integral, and normal part of centering prayer. You know, so you don't have to beat yourself up if you find yourself distracted and thinking about what are you going to have for supper and what movie are you going to see next weekend. And, you know, those are normal. We have them 24/7, right? So the thoughts are not the enemy. The enemy is the ego, our need to control. And this prayer is letting go, letting God be in control. Just letting go, not feeling you have to solve your own problems. You don't have to review your past or plan your future, analyze everything, figure out why you're neurotic or anything. You don't have to do that, you know. I know we'd like to. Our ego would just like to go in there and say, I want to really find out why I'm so messed up, you know. I want to go back to when I was potty trained and all this kind of stuff. And fine, but do it outside of centering prayer. That's not the time to do it, all right? So, inevitable, they will come. It's inevitable. I've been doing centering prayer for, I think I said 37 years, since 1977. And I still have a lot. And I will have a lot till my last breath. Okay? But as you gradually let go and let go and let go of your control and just gently return to God, you are doing practice sessions. You're getting ready for the final act of your life, which is your last breath. Okay? Because you will be letting go of your last breath when you die, right? When we all die. Now, who wants to go into that wonderful, powerful, most important moment in our life without any practice? Who's going to go up on the mountain and go to the diamond slopes of the, you know, ski slopes and say, I think I'll learn how to ski, you know, and just go down without any practice? I don't think so, you know. We need practice. And so this letting go constantly, letting God be God for you, is preparation for that final letting go. When you let go and you know you're falling into the arms of God. Did I tell you the let go story? Huh? Oh, it's one of my favorites. I don't know how I missed it. It's the story of the mountain climbers, okay? This mountain climber, all he wanted to do was climb this one mountain. That's all. That was his life's ambition. So he practices for months, and he gets all the equipment, and he starts finally climbing. And it's such a high mountain, it takes him 6 weeks to get anywhere near the top. And so he's just about ready to touch the top of the mountain. And his foot slips, and he starts falling down the mountain. And he's grabbing for everything he can. Finally, he gets hold of this little branch that's coming out. And he's holding on for dear might. And he's crawling out, help, anybody up there, help me. All of a sudden, a voice says, all right, this is your loving God. He said, oh, thank God, I'm saved. God, what do I do? I can't hold on much longer. And the voice says, all right, just let go and fall into my ever-loving arms. Well, he can't believe what he just heard, you know. He's looking down at the 1,000-foot drop, you know. Alligators and everything, you know. And all of a sudden, he shouts out, anybody else up there? He wasn't kidding. He wasn't kidding at all, you know. And we can laugh because we have been there. God has said over and over, let go and let me be your God. Trust me. And we say, any other suggestions? No. We don't want to let go. We want to hold on. We want to be in control, right? We want to live forever and ever. Yeah, well, as the old saying goes, people in hell want ice water, you know? So, okay. All right. The kinds of thoughts. Kelly really gets some good transitions thing. Okay. So these are the kinds of the ordinary wanderings of the imagination of memory. Anybody got good memories, huh? I've got all kind of good memory jokes. Let me just tell one here, all right? The story of the elderly couple, they were watching television, and the wife says to the husband, "All right, dear, it's your turn to get the snacks." He says, "All right, what do you want?" He says, "I want an ice cream sundae. And I want vanilla and chocolate and strawberry ice cream. Write it down." "I'm not writing it down. I can remember that. And I want chocolate syrup on the vanilla, and I want strawberry syrup on the strawberry, and I want vanilla on the chocolate. All right? Write it down." "I am not writing it down. And I want whipped cream and nuts and a cherry. Write it down." So he gets up furious and walks into the kitchen. 15 minutes later, he comes back and he shoves her a plate of bacon and eggs. And she takes one look at it and she says, "I told you to write it down. Where's the toast?" Memory is critical, okay? I'm convinced that if we had better memories, we would be better followers of Jesus. I really sincerely mean that, you know? We so often forget. God saves us over and over and helps us and everything, and 30 minutes later, we've forgotten. We're panicking, you know? "Oh, God, what am I going to do? Help me." We forget that 30 minutes ago, God just really worked something wonderful. So memory is crucial. But now in centering prayer, memory, it's not the time for it, okay? Let it go. Let it go. Thoughts that give rise to attractions or aversions. You know, those are where your energy, you know, you have some attraction to this one thing, you know, or this, you have this aversion to this one thing, you know, and you're thinking about, you know, anchovies or whatever it is that you don't like, you know. Your energy is going to be there. You're going to be attracted to that. You'll be trying to avoid it. Insights. Oh my gosh, we get this final insight. We've been trying to solve this problem. All of a sudden, bingo, there it is. Let it go. God will give it to you later. Trust that. Not the moment to go into insights. That's thinking. That's solving problems. Self-reflections. Not the time to be narcissistic. You know, the narcissistic person's the kind of person that you're talking with them and telling them something about your life, and they say, "Yeah, that reminds me of something happened to me," you know? And over and over, you know, it's back to them, me. Well, that is not the stance of centering prayer. Thoughts and feelings arise from unconscious. Now, here are the four R's, okay? And it's not reading, writing, and arithmetic, all right? Let's read those. Resist no thought. Retain no thought. React emotionally to no thought. Return ever so gently to the sacred word when engaged with your thoughts. Okay, now exam time, all right? I want someone to tell me why we have up here resist no thought.
Because when you're thinking about what you're doing, and you're not returning back to your thought.
That's right. You're not letting go. You're retaining it. You're holding on. That's the exact opposite of letting go, right? Retaining, right? Holding on. Okay, so, oh, and that's resist. Resist is an oppositional energy. So if I say to you, whatever you do right now, do not think about a pink elephant. Don't. Don't think about a pink elephant. What are you thinking about? I mean, that's the way it is, you know. And the more you resist it, I'm not going to think about a pink elephant. I am not going to think about a pink elephant. What happens? You're focusing on the pink elephant, you know. So, resisting doesn't work. Retaining it, holding on, doesn't work. React emotionally to no thought. Why is that there? Don't let it frustrate you. Okay, what else?
We're in control if we react.
Yeah, right. You're engaged in it. You're in the battlefield now. You're in the boxing ring. You're just, you know, you're right there. You've been sucked into this. It's a little entertainment thing, you know. And meanwhile, your centering prayer practice is going out the window. Then the last R is what? Return ever so gently to the sacred word when engaged. Now, you know, that's a very important word, engaged. It's not just, it doesn't say, return ever so gently to the sacred word when you have any thought. Because you're going to have thoughts. And thoughts are not the enemy. But you let them go. You know, Abbot Thomas Keating, one of the three founders of Centering Prayer, whom I've met a number of times, and he's in his 90s now, and he doesn't go around giving conferences, but he is on the 6 follow-up sessions. We have tapes with him when he gave these 6 follow-up sessions to this three-week centering course practice. There's a 6 session follow-up with videos of Abbot Thomas Keating that are wonderful. And he lives in Snowmass, Colorado, and he's a wonderful, very holy man. So, yes?
Where do you get those?
Oh, we're going to be teaching them here after this.
Oh.
And you remember when we had last week, we had Tom Cardis, who is the coordinator for Contemplative Outreach of Western Michigan. Remember we told you about the website, COWM, Contemplative Outreach of Western Michigan. He's the coordinator for that, okay? And he's going to be, for those who would like to deepen your experience, he will be teaching and using those videos of Abbot Thomas Keating, the Trappist monk, who really developed all this to go deeper, all right? So, when I was in my training, we worked and focused on the word engaged. What is to engage? What does that mean?
You're participating.
Participating.
Involved.
Emotionally charged, right? And you're engaged in something. It's just not something fleeting. It's, you know, you're engaged in that. You know, it's like, you know, someone that's really watching an exciting football game or something, right? And someone tries to talk to them, they don't hear them. They really don't. They're so engaged in that game that it's like there's nothing else going on, is there? Right? So, those are the 4 R's. Any questions about those? Okay. Let's see. Okay, centering prayer is a method, not a technique. Okay? What's the difference in a method and a technique?
A technique is something you do.
I'm sorry?
A technique is something you do, where a method is something more that you allow, I guess.
Okay, that's good. Anybody else? Yes.
I would think of a method more as a way of doing things, like a philosophy behind it, whereas a technique is you follow this step-by-step plan.
Okay.
I'm just thinking of art, and that's how I would do
right.
it.
Right, okay. Anybody else? Yeah, Joni.
Technique could be right or wrong, but a method can't be.
All right. There's something else that's really an important element of technique that I'm not hearing.
Well, I think it would be a skill, and it would be, you would be in control if you had a skill for something.
Okay, all right. That's all part of it, you know. It's just not what I'm thinking about. I've got $1,000 in my pocket for the one that can come forth with this. And, you know, remember, who was it? Johnny Carson Swami thing, you know? The card, you know? Now, what I'm trying to get across is that a technique is done in order to get a certain result. Right? You have a certain technique that you follow if you want to get this particular result. Okay, if you want to play Chopin correctly, then you play this particular way, this technique. All right. A method is not as focused on an outcome. It's a method of doing something. It's a way. We have a way of doing everything, right? We have a way of riding and walking and driving. It's all methods, you know. And I wouldn't call them techniques. Technique is more specific. It's more focused on outcome. I like to, you know, we all have a method of eating, right? I mean, I like the story of the guy that walked into the doctor's office and he had a carrot in one ear and a cucumber in the other and a strawberry in one nostril and a grape in the other, all right? And he walked in and said to the doctor, "Doctor, something's wrong. I need some help." And the doctor looked at him and said, "Well, for one thing, I can see you're not eating right." You're good. You're laughing at my joke. That's great. I'm going to pass every one of you, right? Okay. But the method, it's just, we need a method, a plan. It's like a plan. But there is no specific thing that we're trying to accomplish. We have nothing that we are putting there as our goal. See, centering prayer doesn't have an anticipated goal to reach. Now, I want to, after 2 years of centering prayer, I want to be on the second level of the interior castle of St. Teresa, right? The third floor, whatever it is, you know? No, you don't enter into centering prayer with any expectation. None. You're going in vulnerable, empty, you know, useless. God is not asking you to do anything but let God be God. And that's the hardest thing for us to do. Because we like to be God ourselves, don't we? We like to kind of determine where we're going and what we're going to do and how we're going to do it and how we're going to get holy and, you know. That's the ego, right? It doesn't want to die. Humbling, and that the way the ego dies is through humiliations. Richard Rohr says he prays for one good humiliation every day. You know? So, but we don't usually like humiliations, do we? You know? Because we're so caught up in our self-image. We want people to think well of us, don't we? We want to have a good image. Well, Thomas Merton would call that your false self. You know, the part of you that is just living in an illusion. Last night I was talking about the false self for the whole session on Immortal Diamond. Because the Immortal Diamond is the true self, okay? And the false self is different definitions. It's the little self, the small self, the superficial self, the illusionary self, you know, the separated self. That's all the false self, you know. And it's all the self that causes most of our pain in our lives. I mean, we're worried about what people think of us, you know. And are we doing things right? Are we okay? You know, does everybody approve of us? You know, those are all false self things. And that's what can be diminished in this particular prayer. It's perfect for it because it's a constant letting go of that need. But once again, we don't want to let go of something unless we have something to take its place. And that's the true self that evolves by the false self diminishing. So it's a lifelong process. And but I'm telling you, as a member of the clergy, you know, for 48 and a half years I've been ordained, we have not taught this. We have taught all kind of things about sin and grace and all these terms that most people, you ask them, would you please define sin for me, or grace, or redemption, or salvation? Would you just kind of please tell me in a Twitter what that means? You know, most people, I don't know. I'm just, the reason is we've used churchy language that doesn't resonate with our gut. And so I'm convinced that we need to translate everything that we do in terms of words that relate to us in our everyday lives. And it's all about relationship. Relationship, relationship. You know? And it's just such a challenge to do that. And just words like faith, you know? Faith is not an intellectual assent to a dogmatic truth. That's not what faith is. Faith is a living, loving relationship with God, where you've fallen in love with God because you've recognized that God has fallen head over heels in love with you. And that's faith. That's living in faith, okay? And that's very different than saying, well, I believe in the Trinity and I believe in the sacraments and all that. Well, good. I'm glad you do. But so does the devil, you know? The devil believes all these things. But you can believe all these things and not be transformed, can't you? You can still be in the false self and the selfish self and the greedy self and all that, and go to Mass twice a day for the rest of your life and not be transformed, not be changed. Am I right? Am I wrong?
Right. You're right.
Right. So we have talked more about following laws than we have being transformed and becoming a new person. Like Paul says, all that matters is that you become a new person. And that person is Christ. So that at the end of our life, we can say with St. Paul, with my favorite quotation, Galatians 2:20, what is it? Galatians, you're good Catholic, you know all your verses and chapters, right? Don't ever get in a duel with some of our separated brothers and sisters. You know, you will lose. Don't get it. James 3:10, Matthew 6:13. We don't use the scripture that way. But Galatians 2:20, there's a way to remember that. And by the way, the verse is, I no longer live. It's Christ that lives within me. Okay? My favorite quote. I, the ego, that's dead. It no longer lives. It's been transformed into Christ. That's the transformation that baptism calls us to. Okay? So how do you remember Galatians 2:20? Because an ordinary outlet in the wall right here is how much? No, how much is that? 110.
Oh, 110.
Right. Now, if you got a big air conditioner or a big freezer, what do you need?
A
stove, you need a 220 line. Because in a 220 line, there's power. All right?
Yes.
And that quotation has power. I no longer live, it's Christ that lives within me. That is power. I don't think you'll ever forget that, will you?
No.
Good, good, good. I'm going to quiz you on that next month. Right? Yeah.
Do you think? Don't you think partly God puts us through that process just by leaving us on this earth for all these years, go through the process of life? I mean, don't you think life itself makes you die to yourself? Or
it can, but not necessarily. I mean, there are a lot of people that fight transformation their whole lives. They remain totally selfish till their dying breath. Greedy, you know, lusty, everything. Just, they fight it the whole way. I'm not going to change. It's God's got to change. I'm not going to change. You don't, it's a free act. It's a consent. Life itself can change you. Just the challenges and the sufferings of life, right? Rohr says the two main ways to be transformed are deep suffering and deep prayer. So take your choice. I choose deep prayer myself. I'm not into suffering, you know. Honestly, I kid you not, you know. But it's all about transformation. I mean, you can go through deep suffering and life can beat it out of you and everything else, if you want to call it that. But deep prayer is the surer way. That's the way Jesus taught us. It's all about change. But we're not going to be able to enter into the very depth and presence and heart of God with all this ego. It's just, it won't fit through the door like the camel fitting through the eye of the needle, you know? Okay. So, let's read this. Therefore, during this prayer,
we avoid analyzing our experience, harboring
expectations, are aiming at some specific goal, such as repeating the sacred word continuously, having no thoughts, making the mind a blank, feeling peaceful or consoled, achieving a spiritual experience. Wow. And a lot of people say, well, why do I do it? You know? What am I going to get out of this? You know? If I don't feel peace and so forth, I mean, come on. I'm putting all my time and effort into this, and this is, I don't have anything to show for it? You got to be kidding me. And a lot of people, once they try this and they don't experience this great inner peace and so forth, they say, oh, well, forget that. I'll try something else. I'll go watch more reruns of I Love Lucy, you know? Or Survivor, or whatever it is, you know, that is not going to help you be transformed one iota, my own personal opinion. But anyway, their entertainment. But Richard Rohr speaks of this book, Entertaining Yourself to Death. You know? I'm convinced that a lot of people in life go through life, their primary goals are being comfortable, being secure, and being entertained. And as long as I can have all three, I don't need to pray. I'm doing all right. Thank you very much. And so how do we get people out of that mindset? You know, I've invited some people sometimes to go with me on one of my missions in the Dominican Republic. In February, I'll go down for my 44th mission, you know. And it's difficult, it's challenging, it's a lot of things go wrong, the lights go out all the time, and you don't always have water, and, you know, it's just a different world. It's a third world, right? And I've had people say, you know, I'd love to go with you, Father, but I just don't want to be uncomfortable, you know. If I could stay in the Hyatt Hotel, you know, and you know, go out every now and then, and I mean, come on. Jesus, when he asked his followers to learn about what the kingdom of God is, he didn't give them a textbook. He didn't give them a book of canon law, you know, a theology book. He didn't even give them the scriptures. They weren't even written yet, right? Most of them, at least the New Testament. What did he do? What did he do? Yeah. He said, follow me. And he turned around and he walked right out into the desert before he started his public life. Right out into the desert where there's no entertainment and there's no comfort and there's no security. And he said, follow me. Follow me all the way to Jerusalem. You know? And we say, I don't know if I want that. It doesn't sound too comfortable. You know, I think I'll just plan out my own little life. But thank you very much, Jesus, you know. I appreciate your suggestions, you know. And meanwhile, are we fulfilled? Do we feel like if we had any more joy and happiness, we couldn't stand it anymore? Are we just overflowing with peace and joy and love? Well, if not, why not? Jesus said, I have come that you may have life and have it to what? To the full. Not just a little bit, to the full. And if we don't have the fullness of life, if we're just putting one foot in front of the other and getting through life, you know, and trying not to be uncomfortable and trying to be as secure as possible and trying to be entertained, and if that's all we're looking for, we're going to be basically unfulfilled, aren't we? We're going to find something is missing. And I think that's why you're here. In your experience of life, you found something missing and you want to find it. You want to find that certain something that is in your soul that's not been filled yet, that God hole, if we want to call it that. Am I right? That's what we all want, right? I think someone said the greatest tragedy in life is to be on your deathbed and not have lived. You know, not have lived fullest of life, you know. Just to have lived in such a way that you have not really put yourself out, you have not really gone out in love to the poor and the destitute and all that. You've just been focused on your own security and entertainment and success and comfort, but you know, who wants to die like that? Who wants to die with regrets? Oh, I wish I'd have done that. You've got an hour to live, sir. Oh, gee, I wish I'd have done that, and not this. You know, can you imagine anything worse? All these regrets. And you've got a few minutes to live? Wow! What if we were awakened now and realize Jesus is calling me to this deeper, fuller mystery of life, this ravishing mystery, and I am going to go for it. I'm going to let it happen. I'm going to say, let it be done to me as Mary did. And I trust you. Would our lives be different? Would they be changed? Huh? Hard of hearing, you know, when I get older. All right. There I go preaching, you know. I tell you, we have after our name CSP, you know. You know, the Franciscans have OFM, you know, out for money, you know. and, We Paulist, we have CSP. Can't stop preaching. Some people say it's congregation of semi-Protestants. I mean, there's all kinds of So anyway. So let's go on. The practice. Let's read this. The intention and consent to God's presence and action are the heart and soul of centering prayer. When engaged with your thoughts, return ever so gently to the sacred word. By returning ever so gently to the sacred word, a minimum of effort is required. Okay. And look at that, you know, a minimum of effort. How are you going to take credit in anything if you hadn't put any effort into it? That's exactly what I'm getting at. When you do sitting prayer, you cannot take any credit for anything. Zero. Zippo. Nada. You're letting God just do everything. It's not the American way, is it? You know? If you want to do something right, do it yourself. You know? Money doesn't grow on trees. You don't get something for nothing. Anybody? God helps those who help themselves. Right. We got all these little sayings that we've been brought up with since we were knee-high, you know? And it's just become a part of our being, you know? We kind of don't question them. And they help in, to some extent, in our everyday business world, right? But when it comes to the spiritual life, they're cyanide, you know? They're death. And it's all it's calling is for a new way of seeing everything. That's what the reign of God is. You know, I don't even like the word reign of God. I like less kingdom of God because it's sexist, you know, kingdom, you know. And I don't want queendom either, you know. I don't want anything to do with dictators and rulers that are high and mighty, okay? Jesus came to form a community of equals, right? All in, no one's any better than the other one. Not that we don't have leaders, we need leaders. But, you know, we don't need the ego. And it's so hard to be really way up there with all this power and not have your ego in full control. All right? So, return ever so gently. What is that all about? Why is that there over and over? You've seen it over and over. What does it mean? Did we just leave it out there? Could we just say, return to the sacred word? Why do we say ever so gently? That's deliberately put there, but why?
So you don't beat yourself up over it.
Don't beat yourself up, right. What else?
I was thinking about being non-judgmental. You said you
non-judgmental. Okay, one of these brochures, these sayings that you want to look at, this is from Richard Rohr, from his book, The Naked Now, Learning to See as the Mystics See. He says, by teaching, do not judge, Matthew 7:1, do not judge and you will not be judged. The great teachers are saying that you cannot start seeing or understanding anything if you start with no. You have to start with a yes of basic acceptance, which means not too quickly labeling, analyzing, or categorizing things as in or out, good or bad, up or down. You have to leave the field open, a field in which God and grace can move. Ego leads with no, whereas soul leads with yes. The ego seems to strengthen itself by constriction, by being against things, and it feels lost or fear when it opens up. No always comes easier than yes. And a deep conscious yes is the work of freedom and grace. So the soul lives by expansion instead of constriction. Spiritual leaders want you to live by positive action, an open field, and studied understanding, but not by resistance, knee-jerk reactions, or defensiveness. And so they always say something like, do not judge, as judging is merely a control mechanism. Words and thoughts are invariably dualistic. But pure experience is always non-dualistic. Dualism is that either or, you know, but good or bad, white or black, you know, that separation thing. You cannot really experience reality with the judgmental mind because you're dividing the moment before you give yourself to it. The judgmental mind prevents you from being present to the full moment by trying to divide and conquer. Instead, you end up dividing yourself and being conquered. You like? Good stuff. This is just a sample of what you get in the daily meditations, you know. And I, one of the things I teach more than anything else is judgment. How judging divides us. You know? And that's the very definition of sin. Sin is separation. That's what sin is. Being separated from God. Because the whole purpose of Jesus coming is summed up in John 17 when he said that all may be one as you, Father, me and I and you, that the world may believe that you sent me. It's all about unity. Okay? And so many people think Jesus came to talk about moralism, morality, being perfect, doing things right. No, that's not what Jesus is saying. If we think it's that, we've missed the boat. Jesus had no trouble with sinners. None. Look through the scriptures. Not one problem with sinners. Only with those who didn't think they were sinners. Right? Like the Pharisees, right?
Right.
Okay. Sin is not... And you could say it's integral, just like the thoughts. They're integral, they're inevitable, and they're vital. Or what was the other one? Integral? I think it was those three. Like say Julian of Norwich says, first there's the fall, and there's the rising from the fall, and both are the grace of God. So it's not either or; it's both and. Sin has a place in our life. Some of the greatest saints were the greatest sinners, and they would not have been the greatest saints if they had not been the greatest sinners. Because anybody that dies and goes up there and says, well, here I am, Lord, I know you're busy, and here's my resume, and you see I was really a good person, and I didn't do this, and I didn't rob any banks, and I didn't kill anybody, and I didn't work on my car on Sunday mornings, and see, look, I went to church. Here's my resume. Now just please show me my reserved seat so we can get on with this heaven business, you know? I mean, come on. That's what I mean by the ego. One time I gave a mission in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and I said, okay, how many of you, when you get to the pearly gates, you're going to say, just give me what I deserve, Lord. Nothing more, just give me what I deserve. I said, how many of you are going to say that? I wouldn't, three people, about 100 people, three people held up their hands. I couldn't believe it. I said, well, I don't know about you, but I'm going to only have one word on my lips, and that's mercy. Mercy, mercy, mercy. Anybody else going to have a different word? You know? If you are, I'd like to meet you after this session, you know. Okay. So it's all about mercy. It's all about receiving and not doing. Because so often the doing is the ego. If you get the receiving, if you feel it, you really feel that you've received God's love, the action will overflow, but not your energy and not your love. It's God's overflowing through you. That's a different dynamic. Okay? So ever so gently means not judging. A minimum of effort. Okay. Let's read this. Once you grasp... Okay, what does that mean, a friendlier attitude?
They aren't your enemy.
Not your enemy, yeah. Anybody try this kind of prayer and hate yourself afterwards? I couldn't do it right. I'm no good. You've missed the boat. My friends, centering prayer is built-in failure. You still want to find out about it? It's built-in failure. You can't do it right. Because by doing it right, we generally think of the clean slate, the blank slate, you know? it's not going to happen. We're going to fall. We're going to, you know, we're going to be engaged in all kinds of stuff. And over again, let me tell you, after 37 years of practicing it, I'm an expert at distractions, you know. Professional. You're right.
It sounds like you can't fail at centering prayer.
Okay, that's a good question. The only way you can fail, Thomas Keating says, is by deliberately thinking thoughts, engaging in thoughts, or getting up and leaving the room. Those are the only two ways you can fail. That's it. But the main thing is not to evaluate yourself, not to judge yourself. Oh, I was terrible at centering prayer today. I was just lousy. You know what the word Satan, what the word Satan comes from? It comes from the word Satan, which means the accuser. So whenever you find yourself accusing yourself or being down on yourself, guess who's behind it, huh?
Yeah.
You know, and God is not going to accuse you. God just loves you into change. God does not threaten you into change. You know? It's got to all fit together, my friends. You know, you can't have a God who, you know, loves you and heals you and forgives you and all this and during his life and his miracles. And then, after you die, all right, I got you now. I got your resume here, kid. I remember back on September 3rd, 1981. Look what I got you doing, huh? Can you fall in love with a God like that? Do you think you're going to do that to you? I don't know if you can, but I can't. God does not judge us. I am sincere about that. And when we say in the creed, God will come to judge the living and the dead, right? Oh, Joachim, you're a heretic. Oh, my goodness. Bring out the inquisitors. Huh? And judging needs to be translated. What that word means is not to separate you, but to reveal to you how you have not responded to God's love. And God doesn't say, I hate you for it. But before we can grow, it has to be brought to the light. The apocalypse, the revealing. It has to be brought to the light. Yeah.
I just think of a Bible verse that says that, I think it's in Romans, it's the goodness of God that leads men to repentance.
The goodness what?
It is the goodness of God that leads men to repentance.
Yeah.
Don't you feel like the closer you get to God, the more you can see that need to repent?
Of course.
And that need for mercy?
The greatest saints always thought themselves the greatest sinners. Why? Because the closer you get to the light, the more you see that you're not so wonderful. It's just like if you have guests over, you know, you want to turn all the lights down. So they won't see all the dust on your furniture. You don't want to have a bright light and have visitors in? Come on. You know? So it's all about seeing and revealing, not about judging. Okay. Conclusion. Read this. As we establish the centering prayer practice, we let the thoughts come and let them go. The principle is resist no thought, retain no thought, react emotionally to no thought, and when engaged with your thoughts, return ever so gently to the sacred word. Is this rocket science?
No.
No. It is so simple. But at the same time, it is so challenging. You know? But as I told you last time, I feel like a philanthropist every time I teach this because it has transformed my life. I just can't say anything more than that. And I don't think I could give anything better than what I have experienced in centering prayer. I have nothing to share except from that experience. You know? It's just, I can't imagine my life without it. And for those of you who are not practicing it, I don't know how you're doing it. I don't know how you're getting through your day. I really don't. I'm sincere. Because that's how much it means to me. And I just would love for every one of you to fall in love with this particular way of prayer. Because it is the divine therapy. It is God's love poured out into your heart. And all you need to do is to receive it. You know, you don't have to be worthy of it. And that's our biggest obstacle. Oh, I'm not worthy. Remember the days when we sang that song? Oh, Lord, I am not worthy. You remember that? I used to play it on the organ all the time in a movie theater in Keesler Air Force Base in Biloxi, Mississippi. That's where we had masses down there because it was air conditioned. And I would be playing with this Hammond organ. Oh, Lord, I am not worthy. Didn't have the vaguest idea of what that meant. You know? But I think I got $5 every time I played for a mass. That was a lot of money in 55, you know. So, it's not a matter of worthiness. God does not love you because you are good. You are good because God loves you. It has nothing to do with you. As Merton says, when you get to heaven, there won't be much of you there. Because hopefully you will, like St. Paul, I no longer live. It's Christ that lives within me. So I think our greatest fear of death is that we're going to be annihilated, that we just won't be anymore, huh? So we got to live it up in this world. We got to grab for all the gusto we can. That's the philosophy, right? But this loving God is going to embrace you and absorb you into God's love. And at the same time, you don't lose who you are. That's the paradox. And both are true at the same time. Like Jesus is both God and man, Mary's virgin and mother. It all works together, but it will not work in your logical left brain. You have to put that in your right brain, which is the brain that you use when you go into contemplation. Okay? Well, you don't have to have everything mixed and matched and tit for tat and 2 + 2 = 4 and all that. No. It's a different mind altogether. It's a contemplative mind. Okay. So, let's see. We have some time here. Maybe just, first of all, any questions now? Because this is the conclusion of this particular conference. And you may have said, well, that sounds like last week, huh? What's this new stuff, huh? What's going on here? Well, there's not a lot of new stuff to give you, you know? It's the same old, same old. But I think it takes a long time for it to sink in. Am I wrong? So, questions? Comments? Disagreements, whatever, you know, yes, yes.
How often do you pray during the day?
I do it twice a day. I do it 30 minutes in the morning and 30 minutes in the afternoon, right before supper. If I don't do it, something's missing in my life. I feel like I haven't eaten breakfast or something, you know. It's like, you know, it's just become a habit. So I can say, my name's Joe, I'm an addict, you know. I am. I'm an addict to centering prayer. I admit it. All right? And I hope you will all be addicts, you know. Because it's the greatest thing since a six-pack. I mean, it. Okay, yeah.
Is it okay to do it for longer sessions if the opportunity presents?
Oh, yes.
Itself? Sorry, I mean, that's nice.
This morning, I think I did it for close to an hour, you know. I woke up early and had more time, you know. And it just becomes so much a part of you then you don't even see the time go by. I have a little timer that doesn't click, 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 you know. It's one of these digital things, you know. And I just set it for whatever, 30 minutes or 20 minutes, whatever I have time for. And I have a little bell, you know, that I ring, you know, kind of put me in the ambiance of prayer, you know. I meant to bring it tonight and I forgot it, you know, talk about memory. And I find that by the afternoon comes along, I'm depleted. I've run out of gas. I need more of God's love, you know. And I, for many years, I just started out with 20 minutes in the morning, you know, that was it. And I thought that was, I was doing so good doing that, you know. And then after a while, I just said, wow, I need more, I'm sorry, you know. And so I just, and I didn't feel like I had to. I wanted to. I got to. You know? It's not I got to do it, it's I get to do it. You see the difference?
Mindset.
Yeah, yes, it's so. Yeah. So it's not something I feel obligated to do. It's what I want to do with my whole heart. Okay? You had a comment or something?
Well, I've been trying it all week since last week, and I feel like I keep repeating my sacred word because I have so many. My mind is just
I know.
Going.
You know, it's okay. You may, at the beginning, repeat the sacred word over and over. There's no rule that says you cannot do that, you know. If you like, if you want to do that and that helps you, go ahead, you know. I just think that as you get more involved in it, the need for that sacred word will just diminish, you know. And it'll just sometimes just fade out completely. And there'll be times when you enter into this incredible peace that you cannot explain. You cannot talk about it. You cannot discover it. You cannot analyze it. It's just like dying and going to heaven. It really is. And it's like Rohr says, once the veil is parted, just once, then you can experience this life of God's love, then wow. Everything else is secondary. It's not important. It's just relative, you know? And I guarantee you, if you, and I'm not saying yet, but when you really get into this, you're going to see so many other things in life that are not going to satisfy you. That before, oh my gosh, I just have to have this Monday night football. I just have to have this whatever, you know? I just can't live without it. After a while, it's, you know, it's just not that important, you know. You may continue to watch it, but it won't be with that, oh, I got to see it, oh, you know, that frenzy, you know. Oh, yeah, you had anything else on that? Just, that was it? Okay, that's fine. Yeah.
Is there such a thing as a gentle timer? Because mine goes this way. And it's just so loud, and it just...
Oh, do you have one of these little digital timers?
Yeah, I do, and it beep, beep, beeps like a microwave, but it would be nice if they had something that just donged.
You know what I have? I bought, I don't use, but I have, I've got these little CDs, or DVDs, CDs, yeah, from since Condemnative Outreach, and they're 20 minutes of silence. Talk about a wow, selling snowballs in Alaska, right? I mean, talk about that overhead, right? That's true. 20 minutes. And then afterwards there's this silent little, you know, bell tinkling or whatever, you know, little chime. Yeah, right.
Now where is that?
You can order it. Go to Contemplative Outreach. Google Contemplative Outreach. It's in Wayne, New Jersey. And they have all of these things, you know. Yes, Amber.
Just a more practical thing. A lot of cell phones have them on there with like a bell or something, so you can do it anywhere.
Oh, that's true. That's true. A lot of smartphones have those little things, right? It's a good idea, right? You don't have to buy this little CD of silence, right? You had another question?
I was thinking of something you said last week where, like, you said you go the whole day, like you have your prayer time and you go the whole day, and then you can feel like a change in yourself at the end of the day where you have to do that again. And I experience it too, just from prayer time and then walking with God, and there's times where it's like, oh my gosh, I have to go pray. And I know this is probably like the left brain, right brain thing. I'm probably trying to put it in left brain terms, but I'm also thinking of, like, I read a little bit about practicing the presence of God by
right.
Brother Lawrence, where you almost, like, do you think you're carrying that with you through the day, and then it starts, you become more distant? What do you think is happening? Is all I was hoping to hear you put it into words.
I just think that God is transforming you, little by little, and you don't even notice it. You don't know how it's being done. You don't need to know how it's being done. You don't need to analyze it or, you know. It's just taking place.
That wearing off feeling, though, what do you think? What is changing in you there?
Well, I think you sort of feel edgy. You feel a little more anxious. You feel a little more tempted to judge someone. And when you notice that, then it's a time to go deep, you know? Yeah.
Well, I was just going to say, I think it's more like, and maybe this is my left brain kicking in, but it's like hunger. You know, you eat and you're satisfied for a while, but then you get hungry again, and that's like being hungry for God.
Yeah,
That's
true.
It's almost a natural reaction, a natural state.
Natural, something says, hey, it's time to eat, you know? Yeah. If you pay attention to it, you know? Okay, yeah.
You said you don't go back to your sacred word that often. So if you're getting thoughts like a fly, a bug, or a chair, mm-hmm. and they're just like boom, 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 boom,
yeah.
and you're not concentrating or engaged in those thoughts,
yeah.
just let those keep flashing, is what you're saying?
Yeah, I mean, whatever happens, happens, and it's irrelevant. It's how you respond to it. And if you get angry, oh, you shouldn't have this fly in here, it shouldn't be here, you know. That's you wanting to be controlled. You don't want that fly in there, and you're going to do what you can. You know? That's the ego that wants to control everything, environment, everything, you know. People around you, you know. You ever live with people that want control, you know. I don't want to see any hands, but I mean. we know, don't we? Husbands pushing their wives, you know. Okay. Let me just give you a few quotes here. Yes.
You said that you change your word from time to time. Is it okay to choose that every day, depending on how you feel?
It's you can. Just don't do it in the practice itself.
Right, before.
Yeah, because that's engaging in thought, okay? Now, I found a few quotations that I thought were beautiful in terms of silence and in prayer. Soren Kierkegaard says, if I were a doctor, my prescription would be create silence. Bernardos, who wrote The Diary of a Country Priest, silence is a presence, at the heart of it is God. Baron von Hugel, man is what he does with his silence. St. Maximus the Confessor wrote, the immediate experience of a thing surpasses the concept of the thing. Okay? In other words, this experience of it is much more than trying to describe it. So, I mean, I can describe this, you know, from now to the second coming, right? And unless you experience it, it's like me getting up and talking about water. Unless you've never had water, you won't really know what I'm talking about. Once you've had it, then, you know, we're on the same page, you know? But all I want is for you to have a hunger for it, all right? I'm going to want you to be dissatisfied with everything but God, all right? That's my goal. Yeah, tell me.
Do you achieve this restful contemplation every time you...
No. Sometimes it's just everything you can do just to keep sitting there. It really is. Sometimes it's painful. But it's perseverance. It's perseverance. And you're not doing it to feel good or to feel peaceful. You're doing it because God is inviting you to God's self in union. That's why you were born. That's why we were born. All right? Okay. Let's have a practice. All right? Can we do that? All right. And when we get up first and just stretch and, oh, you know, feel strong and, oh. most teachers here at the Information Center give breaks, you know, in the middle. I don't. I just go plowing through, you know. And I feel, well, if you need to go to the restroom, you can, you're an adult, you can get up and walk out, you know, right? Yeah. So if anybody feels, you know, they need to go to the restroom or whatever, please feel free to go, you know. Otherwise, if you're ready to sit down and... All right. So remember what we said. Are there some people here that this week that were not here last week? Okay? A few people. All right. Okay. Well, last week I spoke about the importance of your body wanting to pray also, which is your posture. Okay? And so it's sitting in a chair that is a straight back. Lazy chairs are not always the best, you know. They're a little conducive to sleep, you know. So, with your back straight, both feet on the floor, not crossed legs like this, you know. Like that, you know. That's not a posture of respect. Both feet on the floor. What did I say about the hands? All right. Yeah, however it's comfortable. But in a respectful way, like open to receive, joined together as a sign of unity, you know, on your hand, you know, that's up to you. There's no rule that says you've got to do it this way, you know. The Spirit will guide you, all right? So we first just put ourselves in the presence of God, remind ourselves that God is loving us into existence at this very moment. And if God, for one microsecond, would not be thinking of us, we would be annihilated. We would just not be. And so we're always loved into this present moment by the mind and the love of God. So we just call that to mind. And that's the last deliberate thought that we'll have. And all the rest is going to be letting God love through you, and whatever thoughts that will be coming, we're going to let that be the divine therapy, as long as you're not controlling them. That's the only rule. Okay? And as soon as you start controlling or analyzing or reviewing or planning, gently return to a sacred word. So you can pick out a sacred word and just use that as kind of an inner tube that pulls you up when you're drowning. Okay. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever will be, world without end. Amen. St. John of the Cross has this saying: Our Father, Mother God spoke one word from all eternity, and God speaks it in an eternal silence. And it is in silence that we hear it. Friends, I hope that you have experienced the power of silence, the healing power of silence, the transforming power of silence, and know that every time you go into silence, you go deeper into the God's love. God's non-judgmental, God's unconditional love for you and for all of us. Next week for the final session, we'll be looking at some of the things that centering prayer is not, and some of the effects of centering prayer. So, it's been a pleasure and a joy to share with you tonight. Hope that you each have a peaceful evening and a safe return to your homes, okay? And you're so welcome. And as I say up here, I have handouts that you're welcome to have on the Immortal Diamond about the false self. So much wonderful things being written out.